Now, it turns out that the code that I ended up having to write to identify these as non-exit events was a little bit more sophisticated than I had originally anticipated. However, I'm going to go ahead and step through that with you because I think there's some valuable fodder in there for you. So, even though it gets a little bit on the tricky side, there's some good functions that you'll learn about in Excel. So, we'll go ahead and step through that. So, to reiterate what our current goal is, we've already identified any of these rate of change events that exceed negative 100 pounds per 2/10 of a second. And now I want us to come in and look at another condition. So I want to find out of those points which of those had just preceding them, and we need to identify what we mean by just, but just preceding them, which of those had a large increase in their weight shortly before them. So I basically went in and looked at the data for all those different points and was able to kind of characterize what was going on. So if we look at this, the data table, this is that very first point that we're just looking at here. So this is this event right here. And I'm going to look at the prior 10 seconds. And I actually determined after looking through all the data that in knowing the process of how we were working, that looking at a 10-second interval before that should be plenty broad enough. And so I'm looking for any real high w rates of weight change within the preceding 10 seconds. And so that's going to be 50 cells, right? We were recording 5 times per second. So 50 cells. So I've just highlighted the preceding 50 cells. And as we look through here, we see, in fact, in this case, we did have a large rate of increase in weight in just the preceding few seconds before that event. So I want to write code now that's going to come in and for every one of these situations where this value is negative 100 or smaller, I want to look at the preceding 50 cells and identify the magnitude of the change. Now, the tricky part comes in that what we'd like to do is just look at that maximum value, right? Maybe in that shaded area there, the preceding 10 seconds, and in this case I can see it was 206, and I could just set some threshold and say if there is one number that the maximum number was over this, then exclude it. Well, as it turns out, when I went through the data, that didn't work. It's not as simple as simply looking at that maximum number. And it turns out that the magnitude of the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth largest numbers are indicative of that change. And so that's what we want to look at. Rather than just coming in and pulling out the max, we want to pull out the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth largest values. So we need to, learn a little bit different functionality to be able to do that, but it turns out that Excel allows us to do that pretty easily. So let's look at the situation first. I'll come in and just try to make this really clear. We'll come in and just say let's find the maximum number in the preceding 10 seconds, so in the 50 cells before this. So let's start by looking at the code that we would need to identify that, and then we can modify it a little bit. Now, I'm going to use a couple of techniques that I don't know that we've really emphasized. So before we jump in, let me come down and highlight those. And I'm just going to create a new sub down here just for temporary purposes, just to come in and clearly explain what it is that I'm going to do here. So the first thing that I want to do is identify this range of 50 cells before that. And we're remember we're counting, we're in a for loop, so we're counting our row numbers. So I want to identify this range of 50 cells here and work on it. And there's some basic syntax, basic ways of identifying ranges that I want to talk about. So remember, we can talk about ranges just using the range object. So I could identify a range just with its cell addresses. So I can actually put in A1 to A2. That's a valid address. Putting in the upper left and the bottom right corners of that range. But the syntax also lets me, when we start typing that, you see it lets me put in cell 1, comma, cell 2. So I can specify the upper right hand range on this, or upper left, excuse me, upper left hand cell. And let's just do this, range. So that's the first cell, and then the second cell, let's make C4. And I'll just do a selection on there just so you can see that I'm only worried about this part right now. I want to talk about ways to address ranges. So if I run this, it should go in, and it did in fact identify the range that has A1 in the upper left and C4 in the bottom right corner. Now let's expand on this a little bit. And within here, there are different ways that I can refer to cell A1, right? So I could call that cells 1, 1, and I can call C4 is also known as cells 4, 3, right? Row number, column number. Make sure I've got all the parentheses in there, and that should do exactly the same thing. Let's deselect it over here first and then run that and see if that, in fact, okay, so that identified exactly the same range. So this syntax may be a little confusing at first, but if you build it just the way that I showed you, so we've got the range. This identifies the upper left cell, and then we have a comma, and then I identify the bottom right cell. And the reason this is such a useful thing to know is that when we get into for loops and we want to identify a range based on a changing variable, this is the way that we want to do it, or one way that we want to do it. This is a really common way of doing it. So now instead of putting in cells 1, 1, I can put in a variable reference. I can put cell R1 and cell R plus 3, for example. And then if those are working within a for loop, so I've got for R equals 1, 2, 3, and then my next R. So if I had, something like this set up and we were to do that, we can see that it identified the range based off the value of R, and it'll become apparent now when we go to the next level of R in that for loop. Okay, so by using this approach to addressing, we can have our range respond to a variable in our code. So this is the first idea that we're going to use coming in up here. The next idea is a really powerful tool within VBA, and that is that I can create objects. We've already done this, but maybe not quite in this setting. So I'm going to, in my code, I want to come in and set, use the set keyword to create a new object. This will be a range object that has whatever address I want it to have. And in this case now, since I'm doing that, I don't want the select thing on here. So this would create a variable or an object with the name my range that's going to be equal to that range. And then I can just operate on that thing named my range as I would any other range. So let's look at using this approach up here. So we come in, we said if the weight change is less than negative 100, then we want to do some stuff. So the first thing that I want to do is, if that is the case, so let's look back over here at our example. So it was right here is where I wanted to look at the preceding 50 cells. So it's going to go from row 293 down to 342 in this particular part of the loop. But so I want to set my range equal to, I'm going to use that same syntax approach that I did below to identify what the range is, and I want it to be cells in this case R minus 50, right, as the first row that I want to get. I want that relative to R. So R minus 50, and column 4, I think. And then the bottom right corner is going to be cells R minus 1, and the same column. And let's close that and see what I've got. Probably have a parenthesis error there. Sure enough, yeah, I didn't close that parenthesis right there. I think that should be right. Okay, so it looks like that worked. Okay, so now that we've identified that range, then we want to come in and we want to look for the maximum value in that range. And here we need to use an Excel function. So, and I want to have another if condition here. Before we do the if, let's just create a variable, I guess. So we'll just call my max value, or my max val, equals, so this is an Excel function, so I have to do application worksheet function dot max. That's how I get the maximum. It's doing this exactly the same thing as doing max in Excel. And I want that now to just simply be the max of my range. So that now creates a new variable called my max value. And now I can add another if statement based on what that is. And I'll just, for right now, I'll just make up something. We'll say if it's over 100. So if my max val greater than 100, then we'll go ahead and mark the cell, or the mark the point in the chart as red. And I need an end if on that, and this is why all this indentation stuff becomes really useful. I can keep track of my nested if statements more easily this way. So let's test this and see how this works. So we'll just step through it. Now I'm going to show you a trick, because we're stepping through each row one at a time, and it's going to go through a lot of them, or most of them, right, where it's not even going to hit this first condition. And I don't want to have to step through every one of those to test this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a breakpoint in inside this first nest, so I can continue to step through and see how things are going to work. So I put a breakpoint. Now I can just run the macro. It'll run until this condition is true, and then it'll stop right here, hopefully. So sure enough, it ran through. So we're now on row 343. And so the next thing it's getting ready to do is to create this range, see if that works. And let's jump over here, and I can come down to my immediate window just to test and see. There are a couple ways I could do this. I could have it type my range address, and it will print out the address. So D293 to D342. So looks like that got it right. The other thing I could do, just to get a quick look at it, we'll just go ahead and have it selected from that immediate window. And sure enough, as soon as I went over there, it deselected it. But I could potentially scroll down and make sure, yeah, so it got the right address. Okay, so a couple ways we could check that. Okay, so let's step into the next piece, and it should find, it looks like 206 is the maximum value over there. And so let's see if it got the, I'm going to keep my capitalization the same. So 206, sure enough. So I found the maximum value in that range. And so in this case, we want to exclude it. So I don't want to mark those things. So what I might want to do is say if the max value is less than 100 instead of greater than 100 here. So it didn't mark that. It won't mark that first point. So that looks like that should work okay. Let's go back over to our code and see, or to our chart, and change the color back on these points. And let's see, that's on this chart, this chart. And Let's easy way to get everything set back. I'll just come in and format the whole data series, and I can go back and do a solid blue fill on everything, and so that got everything set back to default colors. And then let's come in here and try running this again, and then let's take a look over here on this chart. And sure enough, so those first two points that we wanted to exclude are now excluded, and this point that I wanted to exclude is now excluded, and we can go through the rest of the data and see how that works. As it turns out, that doesn't quite get every point that was a false positive, right? So a false exit event. And so I ended up having to do something just a little bit different. Rather than just looking at that maximum value, as I said, I wanted to look at the largest, the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth largest instead of the single largest value in that series of 50 numbers. So let's look at how to do that. And in order to understand this, it'll make a little bit more sense from here. So if we just look at Excel, we're just going to use an Excel function, but instead of max, we're going to use something different. So let me come in and just highlight these cells so we know where we're working. This is the range that we've identified. So let me just shade that. And so we already know that there's an Excel function max. I can do, equals the max of whatever range I wanna do. And so it found that. I can also find the second largest number, and there's a function in here, again in Excel, called large. And you can see right here, returns the kth largest value in a data set. So we're going to use that. And so it wants the array first, so it's the same, same range that I'm working on. And then the second argument is what value? So we'll get the second largest value here. So second largest is 143, and you can go through and examine that and verify that. I can do, let me just do it like this. I'll just copy that. We'll get the third largest number. So we'll come in here and say, give me the third. Okay. So again, here's another worksheet function that I can use to pull out the third. As I said, just from examining the data, I was able to determine the first two weren't really helpful to me. I had some that were actually true exit events that had pretty high values, one or two high values in the preceding 10 seconds. And so I wanted to exclude those top two. And it turns out that the next four were diagnostic. And so that's what I want to do. So let's do that in the code. And we'll do the same thing here then. So instead of using the max val, let's come in and create a different variable. I'll just call it the high value. High val. We call it whatever we want. And so I want this to be a combination of those four highest values. And I decided just to go ahead and use the sum. So I can do application worksheet function sum of, now I've got four different numbers in here. So I've got application worksheet function large, my range, third largest. There's the first value I want in that sum. And then I need a comma, and I can do the same thing. Well, you can already see I'm going to be typing this string, application worksheet function dot something, a bunch, right? So just to make this much easier to write and much easier to read, instead of doing all that, let's just use a with statement to abbreviate this. So I'll say with application worksheet function. Then I'll have an end with, and then I can have this code inside of that with statement, I'm gonna go ahead and delete this because we're not gonna work with that maximum value anymore. So I'm now using my high val, and I'll just do it now just because I'm thinking about it. I'll go ahead and change this. All right, so now I can get rid of all the application worksheet function things. So this will be just dot. I still have to have the dot in there because I didn't include, it's not included up here. So we have to have the dot sum. Is the sum of large my range 3 dot large my range comma 4 comma for the next argument in this sum series dot large my range 5, and it turned out that I needed to have it work best if I had the sixth, third through the sixth, so my range sixth largest value, close that, and I think that that should now do it. Let me stretch this out so you guys can read the whole string on there. So this is creating a new variable. I only use this with statement so that I could abbreviate, you know, all those long words in this particular line. So I've got the sum now of the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth largest values in my range. And I know that going through and looking at that now, that the value that I wanted, when I add all four of those up, 170 was the threshold that I ended up using. Again, just from examining the data, I know that that works. So let's test this. I'll go back and clear out the marked points on that other chart, and then we'll come in and run it. See. Okay, so I've reset the marker colors, run that, and come back over to our chart now, and it did, and if we go through the whole series on here, we would find that this did accurately distinguish the points that I wanted to. So just one final thing that we want to do, that's really not ultimately what I want to do. What I want to do is I want to have a column on here on this continuous weight sheet that marks those endpoints, and I just want to put a 1 in there, leaving blank if there's not an endpoint, put a 1 if there is. Let me delete this stuff out that I played around with, make sure there's nothing else. Okay, and so real simply then on our code, we've got everything set up. It comes down and then it gets to this point and it changes the color on that chart. Let's quit doing that, so I'll just comment that out, and instead we just very simply want to have it come in here and put in on that sheet. So in cells, whatever row that I'm in, and in column 6, all right, so row or column 6, value equals 1. And then the other thing that I can do now is, I know I'm not going to have another endpoint. I'm thinking about my for next loop now. So right now it's sitting on column R, and I want to advance it down a little bit. And the reason for that is that I know, so the original thing I was looking for was a value less than negative 100, so it found one. And then right now we're just stepping through a row at a time, right? So it's going to come through now and it's going to look at the very next cell and it's going to hit up, you know, a true for that if value is less than negative 100 again immediately, and it's going to go through that whole thing. And I don't want to do that. I want to get past, I know that every time I get a, you know, something that's substantial, we can tell that looking at this chart. Here's one that made negative 100, and then right after that, there's another one, right? So we get a lot of those. And so we want to step past all those before we start looping in again, and that's pretty simple. All I need to do is come down to the bottom of my code here, and after I've done this, we'll just increment R by a set amount, and it turns out I think that adding just 10 lines to that's sufficient to make sure we don't hit all those additional values that are less than negative 100. And so that code pretty well works for what we want to do. So that'll come through if I run that now. Make sure I'm in the right place to run it. The way I wrote that, I have to have this sheet selected for it when I run it. So if you're going to do that, this might be a place you want to put a button right on the sheet so that you force people to be in that sheet to run it. And whoops, it didn't know where I was. So let's run that. And now it should have run through, and it should have in this column there. I'm just control down arrow, and it looks like it's marked a bunch of values. And we can go back through and double check. I already have. It looks like it worked pretty well. So that's taken us through some pretty sophisticated kind of programming to analyze a lot of data and be able to process it and have it kind of intelligently go through and find some patterns in there that alternatively you might feel like you had to do manually. But by inspecting the data and paying attention to the details of that data, we were able to come in and automate that whole process.